Well, good afternoon. I'd like to welcome all of you today to our Thanksgiving service for Brother Christian, or Chris Meyer. It's so good to have so many of you here today on behalf of Sister Evelyn, Daniel and Susie and their children. I want to thank you all for coming along this afternoon. Brother Chris gave me two guidelines for the service today. He said, number one, this is to be a Thanksgiving service to the Lord. And number two, say very little about me. Well, we can do the first. We can mostly do the second. And it'll be a blessing to hear a little about Chris's life and the blessing that he's been to each and every one of us. This is a day of Thanksgiving. It is tinged with sorrow. It is tinged with precious memories. We are all the richer, the blessed for knowing Brother Chris and his love for Christ, his testimony. But let's thank God and give him glory for the good things he has done through his servant, the blessings which we enjoy today. Before our first hymn, please join with me in a word of prayer. Loving Father, we thank you for this day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We've already experienced your morning mercies. And Lord, we have been blessed in being able to be part of this service this afternoon, in loving memory of your servant, Brother Chris Meyer. Thank you, Lord, for the goodness you showered upon him, upon his family, upon his friends, upon, Lord, his church family. What a blessing it was to know him and to worship Christ with him. Lord, we thank you that you mercifully redeemed his soul from sin, set his feet upon a rock, and set his heart towards heaven. Lord, we thank you for his steadfast faith and for his resolute hope in the gospel of Christ. Lord, we pray that you would bring great comfort today, that you would bring special blessing upon Sister Evelyn, upon Brother Daniel and Susie and the children and extended family, that they would know your very presence, that their hearts would be inclined to you now, Lord, and certainly in the days ahead, knowing the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, that transcends even the loss that they certainly feel. I pray that you would surround them with the good memories and with the blessings and the sure knowledge that the husband and their father and grandfather is in your eternal presence. Lord, I pray that we would above all bring honor and glory unto your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, Chris's Savior and Lord, his Master and his friend. We ask that we would be able to leave this place today knowing the goodness of God ourselves and knowing the joy that only the gospel brings. We commit this service to you in Christ's precious name. Amen. Would you please open your order of service? Every song today has been chosen by Brother Chris. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Let's stand and sing on the introduction.
Spirit. those of you who don't know me, my name is Nicole, and it's an absolute privilege to be able to share with you today. Chris first came into my life about 7 or 8 years ago. I can't remember exactly when, but when he and Evelyn started attending this church. And there's many people here today who have known Chris a lot longer than I have, but I think we could all agree that he had that very special kind of warmth that almost from the moment you first met him, you already felt like you were old friends. His warmth and cheerfulness are just some of the reasons that I would like to give thanks to God at this celebration today, because today is a celebration. And in the few minutes that I have, I'd like to share some more of those reasons why we can give thanks for Chris. I count it a tremendous privilege that over the last 6 months especially, I was able to grow closer to Chris and Evelyn. As God would have it, through my work at Sunshine Hospital, I was able to spend many special times with Chris. When Chris first came to hospital last year, I was glad that if he had to be in hospital, I'm glad it was Sunshine, so that I could go and visit him. It was my hope that in some small way I could be there to be a minister to him and be a blessing to him. But the more that I reflect on it, I think that God put Chris there so that he could minister to me. At various times in our visits, we were interrupted by different health professionals, and they would often look at me with this puzzled expression like, "I know you're not his wife, and I don't think you're one of his kids, so who exactly are you?" And Chris and I had this joke that if anyone did actually guts up to ask, that he would say, "Can't you tell we're related? She's my little sister after all." And he did get a chance to use that line. Despite the pain and the hardship of those final months and his battle with his health, Chris's faith was never more real to him. And this has left a lasting impression on me. There were tears he shed at times, and there were deep waters to traverse, but the reality of Jesus was an anchor of joy to him. You see, Chris's first love was Jesus Christ. It reminds me of John the Baptist, who said of Jesus, "He must increase and I must decrease." And this is how Chris lived. Even as Pastor Rob mentioned, in planning for this memorial service, Chris insisted that today be all about his Lord. I have some very sweet memories in that hospital room, listening to hymns, singing hymns with him with what voice he had left, and they were very special to me and to Evelyn. You see, the praise of his Saviour was never far from his lips. Today, I am grateful for the way that Chris loved Jesus. But we know that Chris had another great love in his life, and that was Evelyn and the beautiful family that they had together, Susie and Dan and Paul and Jen and Winter, Lachlan, Emberly, Alexander. I think I've got everyone. Not so long ago, I had the chance to ask Chris to tell me their love story, how they first met. And this is the short version. From the moment she walked into church, I think it was, he was completely smitten. "That's the woman I'm going to marry." And after some convincing, Evelyn finally decided that he wasn't such a bad sort after all. I always think that he had a certain twinkle in his eyes whenever he spoke of Evelyn. There were times in the hospital when he would share with me his concern for Evelyn and reflected on how good she'd been to him and how hard she'd care for him. And then I would see Evelyn or talk to her on the phone, and she'd be like, "I'm just so worried about Chris, and he's been so good to me." You see, their concerns were always for each other before themselves. And I'm grateful to God for the love that Chris and Evelyn shared, for their faithfulness and devotion to each other. I'm grateful for the beauty, not the perfection, but the beauty that comes from a marriage where Christ is at the centre. And lastly, I wanted to share that in loving Christ, Chris loved the family of God. His kindness blessed many lives in the various churches that he attended over the years. I'm grateful that later in life, God led Chris and Evelyn to Open Door Baptist Church. We got to have him at the end. His life and testimony blessed his brothers and sisters here in this local assembly. And I can say that with certainty because they told me. Although I couldn't get to ask everybody, there were some people in the church where I was able to ask why they thanked God for Chris. And I'd just like to share some of those responses. Dineshka told me that she's known Chris for about 6 years, but it feels like a lifetime. And she has a memory when they were at the, when she was at their home with a meal, and Chris read the Bible and they had a time of prayer. I absolutely cherish that moment, she said, and many like it. I looked up to him for his love of God and for always putting him first. Brendan told me that he was grateful for Chris's willingness to help on the farmhouse and the great time of fellowship that they had talking about his life as a carpenter and as a Christian. And Brother Lucas said that he was thankful to God for the beautiful memories that they created while Chris taught him how to drive a manual. Chris's support and encouragement was always motivating while I learned to drive, and clearly he passed on some knowledge because Lucas passed. And I'm especially grateful for Chris's loving and generous heart and how kind and warm he was to me. I'm grateful for how Chris would send me some game suggestions for the youth group, shared Pastor Glenn. It was something little, but it showed that he cared about the youth and all the leaders involved. I think we can say amen with Paul and Maria when they shared with me that we are so thankful and blessed to know Brother Chris. We know that he loved the Lord so much, especially the last prayer meeting we had at their place. Even though he was in bed and very weak, he still wanted to pray to his Heavenly Father, and it was beautiful. Today he's in the Lord's presence, rejoicing in his everlasting life. To God be the glory for Brother Chris. And we can all say, amen. Linda is particularly thankful for Chris's openness in sharing his struggles and his down-to-earth conversations. He was an encouragement to me, and I will miss his hugs and his genuine care. When Edmund and Susanna first joined ODBC, Chris was one of the friendliest, who always made us feel welcome. I think we can agree with that sentiment. He's always had a joyful disposition and always made time to talk to our girls. What impressed us most in the short span of time we knew Chris was this. Despite his struggles in health, he was still concerned about others. We thank the Lord for the privilege of knowing Chris and for giving us a glimpse of a man whose faith never wavered. But I've left the last word to Ellie and Diana. God blessed us with the most loving neighbours we could ever have, Chris and Evelyn. There are so many things about Chris we are grateful to God for, but above all is Chris's loving care towards us. God didn't just send us a neighbour, he sent a friend to us, a role model and a brother in Christ. He would give us words of encouragement, advice and always a good laugh. Chris left a great legacy in our hearts, and though we miss him, we rejoice that he is now with our Lord and Saviour.
Thank you so much, Sister Nicole. That was a great blessing. We're going to sing now, Worthy of Worship, Worthy of Praise, Worthy of Honour and Glory. We'll remain seated and sing this song.
Thank you. chapter 1, verses 19 to 26. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor, yet what I shall choose I cannot tell. For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you, and being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again. Amen.
Brother Chris requested, I'll turn this on. Hope you can hear me now. Our brother Chris requested this hymn was read out rather than sung, just so that I guess we can appreciate the wonderful words that it has. It describes in some detail just how much the Lord Jesus Christ has done for those who trust him. So I'll read it out, and hopefully as you read along with it, you feel that same affection and that same appreciation of this hymn that our brother Chris had. His robes for mine, O wonderful exchange, clothed in my sin, Christ suffered neath God's rage. Draped in his righteousness, I'm justified. In Christ I live, for in my place he died. I cling to Christ and marvel at the cost. Jesus forsaken, God estranged from God. Bought by such love, my life is not my own. My praise, my all shall be for Christ alone. His robes for mine, what cause have I to dread? God's daunting law, Christ mastered in my stead. Faultless I stand with righteous works not mine, saved by my Lord's vicarious death and life. His robes for mine, God's justice is appeased. Jesus is crushed, and thus the Father pleased. Christ drank God's wrath on sin, then cried, 'Tis done. Sin's wage is paid, propitiation won. His robes for mine, such anguish none can know. Christ, God's beloved, condemned as though his foe. He as though I, accursed and left alone. I as though he, embraced and welcomed home. Thank you.
man may strive to go beyond the reef of space, to crawl beyond the distant glimmering stars. This world's a room so small within my master's house. The open sky, but a portion of his yard. How big is God? How big and wide his vast domain? To try to tell, these lips can only start. He's big enough to all his mighty universe, yet small enough to live within the heart. As winter's chill may cause the tiny seed to fall, to lie asleep till waked by summer's rain, the heart grown cold will warm and throb with life anew. The master's touch will bring the glow. To live within my
since he's cleansed and made me my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! Out of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art!
How great thou art!
How great thou art!
How great thou art!
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art!
Thank you, Dan. That was wonderful. Would you join me now to sing the next song in our order of service today? When my life work has ended and across the swelling tide. Brother Chris has done that. And he enjoys the bright and glorious morning where sun never sets. Let's stand and sing this hymn on the introduction, When My Life's Work Has Ended.
Come. Psalm 116. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call upon him as long as I live. The pains of death surrounded me, and the pangs of Sheol laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I implore you, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord, and righteous. Yes, our God is merciful. The Lord preserves the simple. I was brought low, and he saved me. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I believed, therefore I spoke. I am greatly afflicted. I said in my haste, all men are liars. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord, now in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly, I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
It's my privilege today to speak as Chris's pastor and also as his friend. My family and I have many fond memories of Chris and Evelyn, many times in their home and also in our home. Chris, as we already know, is a man who loved God and who loved his family. He loved his Dutch heritage. I told him once, Chris, you're the first Flying Dutchman that has joined our church at Open Door. And he was very proud of that fact. Chris was a gifted builder and constructed beautiful woodwork and other items. You see some of these here this afternoon. A windmill to scale, not quite finished, but very functional, as you can see. He did a beautiful handcrafted wooden jewelry box for our family. One of them is there on the table as well. Hopefully after the service, you can come and have a look at those items. There are some precious memories there as well. I remember that during the COVID interruption, our children sort of forgot what some of the church people looked like. And I mentioned Mr. Meyer to them, and they looked at me like, who's he? I said, you know, the man with the cap. The guy wore the cap. Oh, him. Yeah, him. So even Chris's cap, beautiful woolen cap, is on display today. We remember Chris with a steadfast hope in the Lord, who eagerly awaited his home call. Chris was very helpful when it came to this service. He picked all the songs, though he left the scriptures up to me. He was happy with whatever I chose. I did mention to him Philippians 1 that was read today, certainly resonated with Chris's earnest expectation. And I felt that Psalm 116 would fit the occasion as well. We don't know who wrote Psalm 116. We surely know who wrote the book of Philippians. In Psalm 116, we have an unnamed songwriter who thanked God for divine deliverance. In Philippians, we have an apostle who thanked God for grace during his imprisonment. And though our brother has passed away, I would suggest that God did deliver Chris. He did deliver him. He did take him from this cursed world, from a bed of sickness, a bed of prolonged sickness, into the very presence of his God and his King. Verse 1 and 2 of Psalm 116 says, I love the Lord because he heard my voice and my supplications. Chris was a man of prayer. He loved to pray. He loved to join us when we prayed together as a church family. In those remaining months, he often shared his burden that God would bring revival to the church. That was often on his heart. He saw the state of the world, but also the state of the church, and knew that the only solution was that God would send his reviving spirit in our midst. Chris did call upon God as long as he lived. And he was very much at peace in going to be with Christ. As was read in Philippians 1, Paul said that Christ would be magnified in his body, whether by life or by death. For to me, Paul says, and Chris said, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. When sickness and illness come, and the ordinary pleasures of life disappear, what does someone have left? Well, Chris had his Saviour, who had been with him in the good times and was with him in the hard times, in the difficult times. And the blessing is that when God strips away all of the externals and all the things that we take for granted, our health and the pleasure of living, we still have Jesus Christ next to us, his Holy Spirit within us. Chris had an acute understanding of that very truth. We hear the expression to seize life's opportunities. Well, let me tell you that death brings its own opportunities. Death brings its own opportunities. And the main opportunity that death brings is that we look at our life and say, Lord, what do I need to do? Am I ready to meet you? If I am ready, Lord, help me to use the time I have to spread God's word. And Chris certainly did that. There were many doctors and specialists and nurses and different hospital assistants who were very blessed to come past Chris, who, when he could, did give a word of testimony. He was looking upward and seeing him at Sunshine Hospital over those weeks, even months. He shared rooms with people who were in bad ways, who sadly did not have the same hope and the same confidence. Well, Chris was there also for them. Death really is gain to a believer. It is if you believe in eternal life. It is if you believe that we're given on this earth 70 in modern language, 70, or maybe some more. If you believe in eternity, death is really gain for the believer. Chris is with his Lord, awaiting the resurrection of his first body, one day to receive a glorified body like that of his Saviour. Jesus said at Lazarus' funeral, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. These words could have been said of Chris. Indeed, every person who has put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Chris will be the first to admit that he needed God's forgiveness in his life. And all that God gave him, a beloved wife and children and grandchildren, he would ascribe to the good hand of God. Because the truth is that all the good things we have do come from God, the Father of lights, James 1 says, in whom is no variation, not even the hint of change. He's always the all-giving God. But the psalm continues, and the psalm writer talks about the pains of the grave that surrounded him. And the psalm writer calls out to the Lord to deliver him. Now, Chris was praying for an eternal deliverance on his deathbed. He wanted the Lord to take him to be with himself. God in his providence gave Chris and his family some notice. Remember a few weeks ago, the doctors contacted Evelyn and said that there's likely a day or two, gather the family and friends. Well, the good physician gave him 2 more weeks. The good physician rallied our brother for those days and weeks. And so there were precious extended goodbyes and further times of prayer and comfort. these were precious gifts of God that that not all receive. Our times, our days, even the hours are in God's hands. They are gifts that God wants us to use. In verse 12 and 13 of Psalm 116, the psalm writer asks this question, what can I render to the Lord for all of his benefits toward me? He says, I'm going to take the cup of salvation and I will call upon the name of the Lord. This was a man who was going to enjoy his salvation. He would keep drinking from that inexhaustible cup of God's forgiveness and grace. And that's what believers can do today. There'll be tears today. There'll be some more on their way. But even when they come, we, along with the psalm writer, need to take the cup of God's salvation. His deliverance. This goes beyond the forgiveness of sins. This goes to God helping us every moment of the day. And to call upon the name of the Lord. God is very near to those of a broken heart. He comes to those who are of a contrite, broken spirit. This is just the company God is looking for in our deepest need, our deepest loss. Verse 15, a very well-known verse that comes to mind during these times, is precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. The word precious has the idea of highly valued, a rare item, an old collectible, valuable item. God sees the death of his one of his sons or daughters as something very, very precious. Remember, Jesus in Matthew 10 said that not even a sparrow, not even the cheapest sparrow that you could buy at a market, falls to the ground apart from your Father's will. If God attends the funeral of sparrows, how much more is he with us today? And how much more grace does he pour upon those who love one of his redeemed children? At death, believers receive their final installment of salvation. They get that last portion, forever with the Lord. To be with him without the distractions, without our sin nature that is always dragging us down. Chris no longer has that limitation. The limitations of body and of tiredness and of weariness and of weakness. Chris no longer operates under those limitations. He can serve the Lord freely. As he always wanted to, he now can. Chris did have a good singing voice, did he not? Well, he's singing better than ever now. He's joined the heavenly throng. As one writer said, the Lord watches over their dying beds, smooths their pillows, sustains their hearts, receives their souls. Those who are redeemed with precious blood are so dear to God that even their deaths are precious to him. The deathbeds of the saints are precious to the church. How many lessons we have learned. We have young and old here today. These gatherings are just as much for the old as they are for the young, for our lives go by very, very quickly. And it's good to be reminded that our life is more than the 9 to 5, the hustle and bustle, from this meeting to another meeting, this gathering to another gathering. Our life is about getting ready for eternity. So today is a Thanksgiving service. We're thankful for the life that God gave our brother Chris. We are thankful even more for the eternal life he gave him by faith in his son. For his faithfulness as a husband and as a father. For his love and service for Christ. For the grace that God gave Chris in his life and in his death. And for the grace God will give us, to sustain his dear family as they readjust. And his life becomes somewhat different, but certainly enriched by the memories of our brother Chris. I'd like to mention just a few things today before we have our final hymn. and prayer. As you know, there will be a burial service held tomorrow at noon at the Emerald Cemetery, 180 Maxfield Road, Avonslea, and all of you are welcome as you are able. It may well be very warm tomorrow, so you might want to bring an umbrella or a wide-brimmed hat, something like that. And of course, if you can stay after our service today to have some afternoon tea, to come and have a look at some of Chris's possessions and handiwork, to express your love and greetings to the family. And so, if you would join me in singing, this will be our final hymn today, "In Christ Alone My Hope Is Found." A well-loved hymn in our church family, certainly captures so wonderfully our hope in Christ today. So as the introduction is played, please stand and we'll sing "In Christ Alone." Chris, look forward to one day worshipping alongside him at the throne of grace. I want to make this benediction our closing prayer for today. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.